I serve as the International Experience Committee on the School of Business Student Council's co-director. I'm also involved with CSA as the event coordinator, and I'm also currently Miss HUCSA. Besides that, on campus, I'm also in the honors program for the School of Business, and yeah, that's about it.
And for me, I'm currently serving my second year as the Pi Network Director for the Howard University School of Business Student Council. I'm also the LGBTQ Student Assistant within the Office of Student Life and Activities, and so I work on the student handbook, legislation, and things regarding that. I'm also the Marketing Coordinator for the Howard University Supply Chain Student Association. I'm a member in the 9th class of the Freshman Leadership Academy. I'm also a member of the Caribbean Student Association, and yeah, I think that's it.
Doesn't mean networking is about forming bonds and relationships with people. In my perspective, the best type of networking is when you're just being yourself. There's a mannerism in which you can go forth being professional and still expressing yourself. Basically just putting forth your brand while you're talking to people, letting them know like what you're really passionate about, what your aspirations are, but also having the intention of listening to other people and learning about them as well. I feel like a lot of people get lost in just trying to introduce themselves and get their points across, but networking is an exchange of information. Like, you have to listen to what people are saying to you as well.
I agree. I think networking gets kind of like a bad rep. Like, a lot of people get intimidated by it, but at its core, it's just a conversation. It's just about getting to know the person and also allowing them to get to know you. So definitely, if you're going to participate in networking, don't be afraid to show your true self and to step away from the more professional aspects and just show genuinely who you are, because that's how real connections are formed.
So as I've mentioned before, I'm from Sigma USBI. And back home, basically, you're kind of taught that you don't really interrupt adults when they're speaking, or like people older than you or superior to you. So coming to Howard, kind of getting out of the mindset of like, you know, when two people are talking, like I kind of just have to wait my chance to insert myself into the conversation. That took time for me to learn, like, networking is about jumping into opportunity, putting yourself in the conversation. And obviously there's a way of going about that. You don't just interrupt someone's sentence, but you find a way to get into the conversation, be involved, and also getting in the mindset that we're all adults, or we're all young adults if you haven't hit 18 yet. So it's to the point where, like, having this perspective that, like, this adult is more superior than me, your intelligence can put you on the same level as someone that's way older than you. And to me, that's super important. So I've had opportunities to network a lot. I'm an Anne Fudge Scholar with the Executive Leadership Council. And so the Executive Leadership Council essentially is a bunch of Black executives. And they have this event where they bring us out for like about 4 days prior to the gala for like a symposium. And you're able to connect with a whole bunch of Black executives. And because I made it very clear, like, I'm from Sinker USBI, I'm very culturally conscious. One of the coordinators for ELC made it so that she found executives from companies that were from St. Croix. And I thought that was just amazing. Like, she made sure that I was able to talk to them. I was able to actually, like, trade phone numbers with them, emails with them. And because of that, one of them made it so that I was able to meet the top, like, human resources person for their company. And I got to interview with that company just because I was able to make those connections. And being able to talk to them, like, on a personal level also, being able to learn, like, one of them actually went to high school with my mom, ended up FaceTiming my mom in front of me. It was just something that showed me, like, people have human aspects to themselves. So we kind of put people in these bubbles of, like, you know, this is an executive, or this is someone in this company that I want to work at, so I'm going to talk to them a certain way. In reality, like, they're still people, and, like, getting to know them on a personal level just helped me to see, like, these are companies I really do kind of want to work at, because this person has attributes that I resonate with. And just from talking to them, you learn a lot about, like, why they chose to stay at what company they're at, why they're on the track that they're at. So, like, networking really has shown me, like, what your life really can be like if you just take the time to learn from people.
I agree. Like, networking definitely opens just so many doors, because, like, even, like, we hear all the time at Howard, like, the whole your net worth is your network. Yeah. Like, that's really, really true. And even for me, like, I also own my own nonprofit organization. It's called Waves of Change. And it pretty much engages the Black community in the sustainability movement through education, advocacy, and service. But when it comes to creating, like, those service events and stuff, it's all about networking. Like, everything's pretty much word of mouth. I try to only expose people within my organization to Black environmentalists, which sometimes can be hard to find. And so it's really about, you know, going to like those events. Like I go to different conferences, I go to different events relating to like my field, and I try to just talk to like other people that look like me and see who they know. That way we can expand our network and give more opportunities to the students through my nonprofit. And even on council, it's like the same skill set, even though it's in a different field, because with the Pride Network, like I procure companies from all over across the country to come in and speak, and I try to procure Black LGBTQ executives, leaders, directors. And if you even try to look online, like it's really hard to find out LGBTQ Black executives. And so it's all about word of mouth. It's really anytime I see a recruiter, like even though I'm talking to them, yes, looking for my own interest, I try to make sure that when I'm networking, I'm also looking into, can I procure somebody for the Pride Network? Do they know somebody that might be able to help me with my nonprofit? Like really just seeing and expanding, and really just taking advantage of picking somebody's brain and allowing them to pick yours and seeing how you can help each other. Because for me, that's been fundamental for my position on council, for my nonprofit, and definitely in my personal life as well.
So being a part of the Honors Program, we do a fall retreat every year to New York. And so one of our newest sponsors is PVH. And PVH, basically they're like the mother company to brands like Calvin Klein, Tommy Hilfiger, Speedo, those types of brands. And so basically I met their recruiting officer, or like the person in charge of recruiting, when we went to New York. I was able to talk to him, converse with him, get his email. So basically I reached out to him that way. And then when I came back on campus, he came to do another talk. And I was able to, again, talk to him, make connections with him, whatever. And because I, like, consistently, every time I saw him, I made it a point that when we were given opportunities to network, to, like, remind him, like, hey, I met you in New York. My name's Crystal, da-da-da-da-da. He let me know, like, hey, we're about to come recruiting on campus. Make sure that you apply. The deadline is this day, yada, yada, yada. So I was able to get a first-round interview. I made it to second round, made it to third round, and I finally got an offer. And it all came from really just staying in contact with that recruiter specifically, having him kind of, you know, be able to guide me on what the process is like, but also like getting to know like what he was interested in, so it made him remember me. So he was really, really interested in like how, you know, time affects the decisions we make and how it's like there's like parallel things that contribute to decisions. So like bringing that conversation up kind of made him remember me all the time. I feel like that also attributed to like me getting an offer is because I was someone memorable over the long run.
So I've experienced too, like I know for my 21 cap team, when I was in business orientation, I had Deloitte as my sponsor. What I had done was I just asked my team leader if I could have the contact of Carmen. She was like our connection through Deloitte. And I reached out to Carmen myself and basically just worked to build a relationship with her. And I expressed to her my interest in learning more in Deloitte. And so she was able to set up a site visit just for me personally. I was able to go, she put me in contact with their vice president of their supply chain. And I was able to meet with her and get dinner a few times. And it was really good because going above and beyond, it allowed me to create more of a personal relationship beyond just kind of that barrier you have is when it's only you're coming to meet as a team. Having that one-on-one time is really important. And so I was able to cultivate that, and that led to me getting an offer from Deloitte. While I didn't accept it, however, the skills that I learned throughout that process are still really applicable today. And I think it's a really good example of how networking can open even more doors, even if you might think you have the opportunity already.
Okay, so anyone that knows me knows that I'm really bad at remembering people's names. If you ever see me on campus, I call everyone darling, sugar, or hun. Realistically, it's to cope with the fact that I don't know most That's people's why. Names. I tell people this too, and I also do it to everyone, so even if I do know your name, so that people whose name I don't know doesn't feel any way, you know, I just call everyone darling, sugar, hun. But you can't do that in professional settings when networking. Like, I can't call an executive darling, sugar, no hun. And as such, I've learned, like, the trick to remembering people's names is when they give you their business cards, write down attributes about them that are memorable. And sometimes I even like write in code in case like I accidentally lose it or drop it, you know, that they don't see that I wrote like bald headed man. Like I might just put like bald and just like keep it pushing, or I might say, you know, if they have like an accent from the South, like South accent, like I might put words that like make me remember something about them that makes it like, oh yeah, this is that person that I spoke to about X, Y, and Z. Also, if there was something in the conversation that you specifically spoke to them about and said you were gonna follow up with them about, writing that down as well, because sometimes, especially like career fairs, you're talking to like 15 different people in the span of 2 hours. You're gonna forget something from some conversation. So as soon as you get the business card and you walk off after you ended the conversation, just step off to the side, write some things down on the back of it. And that way, when you're doing the email, you can just flip to the back of the business card and you'll have all that information still, so you can remember like, who is this and why am I, you know, making sure to email them.
The piece of advice I would probably give is just being confident. I think it's really, like, even what Crystal was alluding to before, like, it can be very intimidating talking to grown-ups, especially in these kind of spaces where you might not have as much experience. But I think being confident in yourself, knowing what you bring to the table, and really just believing that you have a story and it's worth hearing. Because I think when you come in with that mindset, it's a lot easier to open up about yourself. It's a lot easier to feel more comfortable. And when you feel comfortable, you have to also take in mind the person that you're talking to's perspective. They might feel just as awkward as you had felt. And so having that calming presence and being able to be adaptable and speak to people, it's also beneficial for them as well. And so really just coming in, knowing, believing in yourself, and coming in with an open mind, and, you know, just trying to talk to as many people as you can.
So I'd say kind of read the room. I feel like sometimes we don't recognize who is in the room, and sometimes you can't prepare because you don't know who's going to be in the room. So if you're in a situation where you can't really, like, you didn't know beforehand to, like, people were gonna be in the room, kind of look around, because sometimes there'd be VPs in the room, there'd be like top executives in the room, but they're just kind of sitting back and seeing who's gonna talk to them. Because a lot of the times people go to talk to who's like spoken, like who spoke in front of the crowd, or like, you know, who someone already pointed out to them. Sometimes if you just pick up a conversation with someone on the side, it turns out to be that they're in maybe even like a higher part of the chain than the person who actually did the presentation. They just didn't do it for whatever reason. Or someone who walked in late. A lot of the time someone's walking in late because they're in a meeting or they had something else to do or something like that. So you really should at least initiate a conversation, kind of learn it from them. And even if they aren't the VP, even if it's something like the VP secretary, getting close to people's secretary is how you get on their list of to-dos. I was able to do that too at ELC, where I saw like a gentleman just standing at a table by himself, and I just came up and introduced myself, told him I was an Anne Fudge scholar. And by the end of the discussion, I found out that he was the VP of marketing for American Express, and that he knew the VP of marketing for BET and all types of other things. So like, you really don't know who's just standing there silently, just kind of watching things unravel in front of them and the type of connection they can be.
That's true. And that even hints at the fact that networking happens anywhere. Like, you might think, like, granted, a lot of times it is in like formal settings, but you never know who's standing behind you in the grocery line. You don't know who's next to you at the gym. Like, just being a friendly person in every aspect and bringing these key networking skills with you 24 hours a day, like always just being open and receptive, because you never know who you can run into, especially within the School of Business. Like, we have executives, but we have a lot of representatives from companies coming in and out all the time, and they just look like normal people. You might even think they're professors sometimes. So even those elevator conversations can end up being crucial, and always remember, everybody knows somebody.
And like, it's super important when you're networking that your brand is always on 100. So like, every conversation I have with someone, I say culture about 5 different ways. I talk about like time management. I talk about, you know, my passion for like enacting change in the ethics of business decisions, and like data analytics comes up like in every single conversation, because not only are you like forming bonds, but you also want to be memorable. So what differentiates you from the other person that just talked to them for 15 minutes? And also, you should make it so that it's authentic. So your brand shouldn't be this way with one person and this way with another person, because like Rachel said, people know each other, people talk, you don't know who knows who. And if I'm over here selling myself as someone who's completely, you know, time management, organization, all this, and I'm over here selling myself as easygoing, going with the wind, that doesn't correlate. That doesn't show that like my brand is authentic. Your brand should be something that you actually resonate with, so that you don't have to fake it to make it. You just kind of you're selling yourself and you're so genuine about it that you don't even notice that every single person, even if they're getting it in a different way, can still say, well, I feel her brand is this, this, and this. And it should be about the same words they used to describe you. So I feel like making sure you got your brand down pat, how you want people to see you when you're networking, that's super important too.
I'm on a money routine. I don't want smoke, I want cream. I don't want no more comparisons, this is a marathon. And I'm aware I've been playing a bet from a lack of promotions. I never was one for the bragging and boasting. I guess I was hoping the music would speak for itself, but the people want everything else.